So we start our Christmas series, a series that for most part we will consider what it is that the Bible talks about as the birth of Christ. But I want to back up a little bit, not just of the Christmas story as it's told in the four Gospels, and we do need, or the three Gospels rather, the three Synoptic Gospels, and rather want to go further back in the annals of history and look at what the prophet Isaiah saw as Christmas. Now, Isaiah lived 700 years before the birth of Christ. And it is God's great power that reveals to Isaiah what it is that's going to happen 700 years from now, that will be given to Israel a king who will be born in Bethlehem. And his name shall be called Emmanuel, the Prince of Peace. This picture that Isaiah saw was very different from the picture that was painted in the New Testament, in the four Gospels. We do not have in the book of Isaiah the shepherds coming to announce the birth of the king, the angels in the air, in the sky, saying glory to God in the highest. We do not have the wise men coming to give gifts to him who was born in a manger, born king of Israel. We do not have all the pictures that we normally would have in the Gospels, nor do we have all those pictures that we see in our Christmas cards. Isaiah saw Christmas in a very, very different light. In fact, Isaiah saw Christmas in a very clear, unadulterated way. He saw Christmas as God coming to this world to rescue the world out of its sin. And so what we want to do is look at Isaiah through the eyes Christmas through the eyes of Isaiah. Because in Isaiah, the clarity of Christmas becomes so great that we strip away all the stuff that we actually see in our tinsel world, in our lights and gifts and Amazon sales world, and we see what it is that Jesus came to do. So, our new series from here is called Isaiah's Christmas, or Christmas through the eyes of Isaiah. If you turn to Isaiah chapter 9, verse 1 to 2, I want to read that passage for you again. But there will be no gloom in her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond Jordan, Galilee of the nations. I think that if you read the verse very carefully, you discover that there is a division of time. In the former time, notice, and then in the... What does the word say? In the latter time. In the former time and the latter time, for some reason, I'm not able to advance it. Maybe you can help me. For some reason, the power is insufficient. Can you hit it twice? Hit your button, the forward button, twice. We experimented with this, and for some reason, it's not going. Yeah. And I want to call the first portion, in the former times, the sins of the past. And could you hit it again? Hit the button again. What's up? Ah, there you go. Oh, now it's working. All right. So, in the former time, there will be gloom on for her who was in anguish. But in the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. You got to know what that former time entails. Really, if you read chapter 8 of the book Isaiah, so this is chapter 9, if you read the portion before it, you discover what God was talking about. Because God was talking to the people of Israel, and he was saying, what are you doing? First and foremost, you have forsaken the God of glory. He is sovereign over all the earth, and you have neglected and you have denied his sovereignty. You are saying, God doesn't know, God doesn't care. In fact, whatever we do, God is not in charge, we are. And Isaiah chapter 8 chides the people of God, the people of Israel, and says, you have forgotten that God indeed is sovereign. In fact, what you have done is taken to yourself all manner of things that try your very best to say that God is not sovereign. What you've done is that you've gone to mediums and you've gone to spiritualists. You've gone to people who are able to say, I'm able to tell your future. So they go to people who are fortune tellers. And in the desire to see God as out of the picture, as the one who drives the earth, who is sovereign over all, they've neglected that God knows and God sees and God is in charge. In fact, what happened to the people of Israel is that they began to consult not just people who call themselves able to tell the future. We'll talk about that quickly. Individuals who call themselves fortune tellers today are people of two sorts. One, they are charlatans. In other words, they are individuals who pretend to be able to tell the future. They will psych you into believing that they can. One of the ways in which they do it is to have general statements as to what it is that people do and people how people behave, and they are very good at reading individuals who walk in. They will ask questions, and from those questions they will say, well, I perceive that you have a problem with your husband and with your children. Of course, here's a very cantankerous woman. Or here's a person who is extremely anxious. Oh, you have problems with your finances. So one of those ways in which these fortune tellers work is that they are charlatans. They are individuals who are good at certain things, but then they pretend to know the future. The second group of these are very dangerous, and that is the group of individuals who are actually in connection with spiritual powers beyond what we can imagine on earth. And that is, they have connection with demonic powers, who occasionally will whisper in their ears the things of the future that they would do, that they would perform. Now remember, demonic powers are super intelligent beings because they were created as angels. They are merely fallen angels. And they are in a spiritual realm that can see us, though we cannot see them. So these spiritual powers will manipulate circumstances so that apparently the individual who calls himself or herself the person who is a fortune teller is able to tell your future, because it's manipulated by demonic powers. And when we come into contact with these fortune tellers, we seem to up lying to you and leading you astray. So even in the second group of people who are fortune tellers, they will be unable to tell you all of the truth. I remember when I was a kid, I was brought to a fortune teller by my mother. And in that, what she said to me as a young child, some of it came true. And my mother was very, very panicked over it. But as a young child, I was thinking, wait a minute, that can't be right, because that's not me. And then so my mother was so worried, she brought me to another fortune teller who told her just the opposite. So one fortune teller said, I would drown because I have a mark on my forehead at the time. Oh, you'll drown because that's where the water is going to be. You can't come out of the water. And so she took me to another fortune teller and says, oh, that mark means that your kid will be very intelligent. I thought, wait, you can be intelligently drowned, right? I mean, that's possible. And I thought to myself as a kid, I was 8, 9 years old, and I was thinking about that. Wait, you got two fortune tellers, both of whom claim the understanding of the future and the truth, and they are diametrically opposed. And even before my understanding of the scripture, I could tell as a child that they were lying. But the problem is, these lies permeate into our society and into the society of Israel at the time. Not only were they consulting mediums, they were spiritualists and fortune tellers, they were actually calling up the dead. So these were called necromancers, people who have seances, calling up the dead and the dead spirits of the dead and talking to them. And what Isaiah chapter 8 is saying, why do you consult the dead on behalf of the living? You have no idea that you are meddling with spiritual forces that you do not know of. In fact, the first point with which you have fallen is they have failed to see God as sovereign over all the earth. That is a huge slippery slope. God isn't quite sovereign. He requires us. He requires our part. If we don't do it, God is helpless. His hands are tied behind his back. It's the philosophy, not only in that time, but today, and not only in our society, but also in the church, that God isn't quite sovereign. I can do what I want. I'm the captain of my own soul. And so when Isaiah writes to the people of Israel, he's saying to them this: you have sinned against God, chapter 8. You have sinned against God by not seeing him as a sovereign, holy God. And you have gone to all these things to consult the living, the dead, on behalf of the living. You have gone to people who have called themselves fortune tellers who do not know the future of their own lives. How can you slip from God, walking on those slippery slopes further and further away? And God therefore will judge you, Isaiah chapter 8. By Isaiah chapter 9, verse 1, he cracks open the future. Despite the fact that in the former times you have sinned, the sins of the past are great, despite the fact that they are so, in the latter time he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond Jordan, Galilee of the nations. Where is this? In the New Testament that Kathy read for us in the book of Matthew, it talks about a land of Zebulun and Naphtali. So that when it was fulfilled by the prophet Isaiah, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Gentile, Galilee of the Gentiles. Beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. What is it? Well, that is the area that surrounds the Sea of Galilee. If you knew your physical geography of the Middle East, you know that there are two lakes that... one is called a sea, but they are both lakes that actually define Israel. The first lake towards the north, the Sea of Galilee, is a lake. And the lake towards the south is called the Dead Sea. And they're connected by a river between them. What this passage is talking about is the northern lake, the Sea of Galilee. In fact, the Sea of Galilee was where Jesus had his major ministry. He did the first and the second year of his ministry in an area called Capernaum. Capernaum is located right where the tribes of Naphtali and the tribes of Zebulun were given heritage. But they had lost it. And through the generations, when they had lost the land that were given to them, Zebulun and Naphtali had lost the land, it was taken over by the Romans. In fact, if you look at the Sea of Galilee, the northern and eastern part of the Sea of Galilee are actually Roman in nature. It's the western part of the Sea of Galilee, where you have Nazareth, Capernaum, that are basically Jewish in nature. The northern part of the Sea of Galilee is really the place where Caesar reigned. The eastern part of the Sea of Galilee was of 10 cities called the Decapolis. The southern part of the Sea of Galilee had a big, big palace, the palace of Herod the king, and later on, which is called the Sea of Tiberias, the place where Caesar reigned whenever he would come by the areas of the Jews. All around that Sea of Galilee, there's only one little portion that the Jews actually were allowed to traffic, the Jews allowed to be. Where Jesus ministered, where he shone the light of the glory of God through his preaching of the kingdom of heaven, was really in the land of the Galilee of the nations. Galilee belonged to the Greeks and to the Romans rather than the Jews, whereas in the former times it belonged to the place of the Jews called Zebulun and Naphtali. You see, this prophecy looked not only at, Isaiah saw not only Jesus' birth, but he saw the fall of the kingdom of Persia and the Medes, the fall of that to the Romans, and how the Romans were now in charge of the land of the beautiful land, on the land of Israel, when Jesus was born, and then when Jesus would come and speak life back into the land of Israel. Sins of the past. The sins of the past will always haunt us. I don't know if you remember, how many of you read The Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens? Anyone? Or at least seen the movie? No one? One person? One Christmas Carol? Well, there's something you need to catch. Charles Dickens was a believer in Christ. What he wanted to do was to write a story engaging enough for his generation to be able to see that they are people who are sinners saved by God's grace. And one of the things that he did with this man named Ebenezer was that he presented to Ebenezer his past. So Ebenezer, who was the Scrooge, would say to everybody, "Bah, humbug, Christmas," right? You remember that? Some of you do from cartoon version of that, right? Of the Christmas Carol. He went to sleep, and in his sleep, his ex-business partner, who had passed away, a true loving believer in Christ, came to him in a dream and dragged him into a place of viewing his entire life. And the first of the ghosts that he meets was the ghost of Christmas what? Anyone? The ghost of Christmas past. And this ghost of Christmas past drags Ebenezer Scrooge through all the places where his life had been broken by broken people. His father was a broken person. His parents lived in a broken world. And all along, the brokenness broke him. And he became a bitter, bitter soul. And the ghost of Christmas past showed him how bitter he had become and the kind of bitterness he experienced. And in that, Dickens wrote these words as the ghost of Christmas past began to unveil for him his past. Dickens wrote into the words of Ebenezer, "Stop! I cannot stand this. Would you stop doing this to me?" And the ghost of Christmas past then says to him, "I do not do to you what you have done to yourself. I do not do to you what you have done to yourself." You see, the past will always haunt us. The issues of the past are huge. And because the huge issues of the past are huge, they will always be there as an unchangeable thing in our very face. 2 Corinthians is a powerful verse, chapter 5, verse 10. "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, and so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil." And some of you sitting in the pews, good Christian men and women, say, "Well, thank God I'm spared from that." Actually, you're not. You are given the opportunity to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And your sins of the past are forgiven you through Jesus Christ. Therefore, you will come because of the merits of His righteousness before God, and God will see you and says, "No sin." But there will be other things that are judged. We will come to it when we look at the book of Revelation towards the end of it. We're going to look at it here, actually, Revelation chapter 20. That just not that the only book that is open is not the book of life. The book of life is that book which actually gives you an understanding of whether or not you are believing Christ and whether or not you will come to the glories of heaven. But there are other books which are open. We'll look at that later on. And what Paul is talking about is this. At the last day, when God calls us home and we stand before Him, there's a judgment of our works before Him. You will not die the eternal death because you have come to Christ as believers in Christ. But what you do when you have come to Him, what you do with your life still matters with God. You cannot fool Him. In fact, Paul later on says in the book of Galatians, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man sows, that shall he what? Also reap. Paul says to us, everything that you and I do in this particular verse is remembered in the books of heaven. Let me just keep going with this. Because Romans chapter 14, Paul again writes in chapter 14, verse 10 to 12. Why do you pass judgment, O brother, on your brother? So now he's talking about you who seem to point fingers at other people. Stop judging other people. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or why do you despise your brother? That person this, that person that. What the person has done, what the person hasn't done. Why do you despise your brother or your sister, your husband or your wife? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. You, personally, your own life, whatever you have done, what you have not done, you will now stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, and God is always living, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess. So then, each of us, and who is he writing to? He's writing to the Roman church. He's writing to the Roman church, which has received the gospel of salvation and has come to Christ because of the salvation of their sin. And he says, for each of us then will give an account of himself to God. Not convinced? Let's go to Revelation, as I was talking about, chapter 20, verse 11 to verse 12. Then I saw a great white throne. We call this a great white throne of judgment. Now, we're not going to get to that until maybe end of this year, chapter 20. So you might forget this. By the time we get there, I'll repeat the sermon. But then I saw a great white throne, and him who sat, who was seated on it. From his presence, earth and sky fled away. No place was found for them. This is the greatness and the sovereignty of God that's being expressed. And then, verse 12, I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books, plural, books were opened. Then another book, singular, was opened, which is the book of life. Now, I said to you that the book of life is that which determines whether or not you'll get to heaven. He wrote in it, those who have received Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, welcome in the joy of my rest. But there are other books which are open. Notice the plural. In fact, John, the apostle, was very clear about this. He wanted you to know that the judgment is not just of those who are goats rather than sheep. That's very clear. Those who do not believe in Jesus Christ, they have now, because of their sin, now ended up in the lake of fire. But what of those who are sheep? What of those who believe? The books are open before you. And then it says, and the dead were judged by what was written in the, what, is it a book or is it a books? Books, plural, right? According to what they had done. Now, I want you to be aware that this book of life is very distinct, because next verse gives you, next slide, and you can have this, I'm going to send it to you if you want it. The book of life written before the foundation of the world. God is sovereign, not you. You haven't any chance to actually think that you can save yourself. It was written before the foundation of the world. Every single one of us, our salvation was written before the foundation of the world. It's found in two places in the book of Revelation. Chapter 13, verse 8, chapter 17, verse 8. But then it was opened on the day of judgment. Chapter 3, chapter 20, chapter 21, and Philippians chapter 4, verse 3. Each of these tells us that those who are believers in Christ will be judged according to the book of life. Okay, those who are not will end up in the lake of fire. But those who are, there is yet another judgment. The judgment of the things that are to come. But also the judgment of your behaviors. What have you done? In fact, Paul says it like this. Paul says, hey, there's no other name by which you are saved. But when you are saved, the foundation that is laid is there. The trial by fire will come, and your foundation is strong. You are saved. That will not be compromised. But build upon that foundation of Jesus Christ, gold, gems, precious stones. Don't build upon it wood, hay, and stubble. Don't build upon it useless things of this world, treasures of this world, things that you have done that you know offend the heart of God. You can say to yourself, ah, I'm saved, God doesn't care. I can declare God's name all I like on the things which I do. No, you cannot. God is saying, I will be the judge in the end. So, the question that I have for us is this. When, serious question number one, when the books, plural, are open before God, what will they reveal about your life? And Christmas is not just about the opening of presents under a tree. Christmas is about reminding us that when Jesus Christ came, He came so that we might be able to live the righteous life of God through Him, the gift of His Spirit. To walk by His Spirit. To walk in His Spirit. To be filled by His Spirit in all that we do. I think that if there's a time of the year, Christmas, New Year's, when you actually make resolutions and so on, it's about time for you to be able to say, hey, Lord, I know that the books, when they're open before you, they show a terrible story. After I came to Christ, I did all kinds of things I should not have done. I thought all kinds of things I should not. I performed all kinds of things that I shouldn't. And did not. I also neglected the things I should. God, would you forgive me for these, and I will repent and make a change. We'll come to that when we close this message, because what I want to do is talk about chapter 9, verse 2. The latter time is going to come, the time when Jesus comes and He preaches righteousness to all the land of Naphtali, the land of Zebulun, all around the place of Capernaum. What's going to happen? Well, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwell in a land of deep darkness, on them, a light has shone. The light of Jesus Christ, when He comes to rescue our world, to give light to the darkness where there is no light, when the philosophies of life lead us to sin, He calls us into light once again. I call that the light of the present. And if you read that, you understand that Christmas was given to us to demonstrate to us that He gives light to us. That's the word Christmas. Now, we live in a world in which we get rid of the word Christ in Christmas. Do you understand? Well, here we go. Xmas. Have you seen that? Why did we say Xmas? Because we don't want to quite, just a real short for Christ, Christmas. But I want to tell you, this came as an inspiration this two weeks ago. What is Xmas? Well, Xmas is missing a savior. When you take out Christ, M-A-S means you're missing a Savior. Christmas without a Savior, Christmas without Christ. You can put up a tree, put up lights, put presents under the tree. You can go out shopping. Good Friday just passed. Everybody was crazy. You got all the things that you wanted to get for Christmas. You go broke. You are in debt. Whatever you do, snow comes down. You're shoveling. You're thinking, oh, I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. Well, okay, go ahead, dream. Then what? After that, but you cut out Christ out of Christmas, you are, what is it? Missing a Savior. You're missing a Savior when you cut Christ out of Christmas. And that's very interesting because we live in a world missing a Savior. We can celebrate Christmas all we like, but Xmas is not Christmas. It's missing a Savior. We have a world that will tell us over and over again, you can leave Christ out of your lives, not just out of the so-called season, but you can leave Christ out of your entire lives, year to year to year, from January 1st to December 31st. Luke chapter 1, verse 76 to 79. This is actually spoken by Zechariah. At the birth of his son, the very first words that come out of his mouth after 9 months of being silent and being unable to communicate, the first words that come out of his mouth were a blessing to John the Baptist as a baby. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord and prepare his ways and give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins. Because of the tender mercy of our God, whereby the sunrise shall visit us from on high, to give those who sit in darkness and the shadow of the death to guide our feet into the way of peace. See, John can't give any of this, the forgiveness of sin, the light in the way. He was to usher Jesus Christ in. In the world and for us, if we begin to cut Christ out of Christmas and Christ out of our lives, we redo our references according to the world. That means, well, you know, other people do this, why can't I? It's okay to lie about this, why can't I? Other people do it and get away with it, it's okay for me to do it. Where's Christ in our lives? Have we begun to X out Christmas? Is our lives missing a Savior? Because really, what Luke is talking about through the in the words of Zechariah is this: when Christ is reinserted back into your lives, there is the forgiveness of sin. There's the light in the place of darkness. There's the walking no longer in stumbling around, but rather the things of this world no longer threaten us because our reference is Christ, His Spirit, and His Word. The Word of God becomes clearer to us when His Spirit opens to us what He says. Rather than actually referencing our lives against the world, we begin to reference our lives according to what God says in Scripture. And John's task was simply to point the way. Not only to point the way, but point to his own life. I have lived life that way. And so we are called to be Johns in our world. We are called to actually prepare the way of the Lord, to make his path straight, so that the light of the gospel of the Gentiles may come to all who are around us. Christmas is about a mission for the believers of Christ. But Christmas is not for us to X Christ out of our world, X Christ out of our lives. Malachi, oops, you can't see that. I messed up. Okay, Malachi chapter 4, verse 2. But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings. Christ heals, and that's what he does. So serious question number 2, you can see past my mess up. Are you Xing Christ out of your Christmas? So that's a good question for us to kind of think about. We can have many, many things. Church is one thing and so on, and we can do other things. We get drunk on Christmas. You know, I had a man who was about 52 when I met him, a captain in the military. At the time, what do you call that? The base was still at Downsview, was still an active base. And they said that there would be all kinds of things that they would do. One of them, those things is send for mental health purposes, various people for counseling outside the military. And this person happened to come to my office one day. He's a captain. He came to me and he had real difficulties. And that's why they said in the military, they wouldn't be able to deal with it. Let's get somebody outside to deal with it. He sat down and one of the things he said to me is this. He said, every time he comes to this time of the year, I saw him during near Christmas time, I get extremely depressed. Why? Because my whole family is an alcoholic family. They came from military, Navy background, and every Christmas, my memory of Christmas was people fighting with each other, getting drunk, throwing up everywhere. And every time it comes towards Christmas, I get extremely depressed because I don't want to live that life, but I know I'll run towards the drink. I'll run towards the alcohol because it's my only place of refuge. We live in a world that has X'd out Christ and has gone to other spirits. Question, have we X'd out Christ during our Christmas? Serious question. Number two. And now for the last one. And that is, as we come to, that's the light of the present. I seem to have run out of, is the life of the kingdom in there? Keep going. Ah, thank you. The life of the kingdom. The life of the kingdom, actually, I take from that second New Testament passage that Kathy read for us. And that is Matthew chapter 4, verse 13 through 17. I'm not going to repeat the Isaiah passage, but I'm going to reread that portion that's the response. This came after John the Baptist was put in prison. And leaving Nazareth, Jesus went and lived in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali. The next verse says, and thus was fulfilled what was spoken by Isaiah, that darkness, a light shall shine in the darkness. But verse 17 concludes that Isaiah prophecy by these words. From that time onwards, Jesus began to do what? To preach what? Repent, for the kingdom of God, of heaven, is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. What does that mean? That means stop thinking that you are living in your own kingdom. When Christ comes, Christmas is about Christ in our world, no longer missing a Savior. Christ's Mass. We were reminded of that by Pastor Vidya last week. Christ's Mass, the celebration, the worship of Christ. When I was in Singapore, the Christians actually loved the word Christmas without the X. Because the word M-A-S in Indonesian or in Malay means gold. Mass is gold. Christ's Mass, Christ is gold. Christ is precious to us. Repent. In other words, turn away from the exing out of Christ, of Christ out of Christmas. Turn away from the things of the past whereby we shall be judged when all the books in plural are open. Because the life of the kingdom comprises of that. The kingdom of heaven is here. The kingdom of heaven is here. When Jesus came and he spoke about the kingdom of heaven, he says, it is here and it is now. I have brought the kingdom here and have asked all my disciples to pray, thy kingdom what? Come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. When the church was established and the Spirit came upon us, the kingdom of heaven has come. It is here. It is right now. There's no escape of the kingdom of heaven being amongst us. Right now, but not yet. Because it tells us the kingdom of heaven is like a seed planted in the ground. And over time, it will grow. You don't know when and how it grows, but it'll grow. First a blade, and then a leaf, and then branches, and boom, a tree that will be so great that you will be unable to fathom how great it is. The kingdom of heaven is here now. God has brought through Jesus Christ. When he came, it was not a baby in a manger. It's to announce this: repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So the kingdom of heaven is here, and when it is ready, when the kingdom of heaven now sprouts forth its leaves, and now is the harvest is ready, then the angels will come, and it'll come for the day of harvest. That's Revelation chapter 21. The day of harvest will arrive when Jesus comes to judge the earth. When the books are opened wide, will the Lord be satisfied? I hope you understand the significance of Christmas. When Isaiah saw it, I guarantee you he did not see a Christmas tree, presents under a tree. That is not prophetic in his eyes. What he saw was this: the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Christmas is all about us being ready for what Jesus called us to do. So, serious question number three. It's going backwards. Christmas, serious question number three. Are you, am I, ready for the second Christmas? You know what a second Christmas is? The second Christmas is when Jesus comes again. First Christmas has occurred. We are adventing the first Christmas. We are remembering that he's coming again. But the second Christmas is coming. Imagine this: if today, by the lighting of the fifth candle, Jesus will return. And you see the first and second candle, third candle, fourth candle. Oh, so cute. The babies are reading. The parents are trying to control them. And then they're lighting maybe the wrong candle. Oh, it's so funny. But what happens if you think the fifth candle is written and the skies open up and Jesus comes again? Are you ready? Am I ready for Christmas number two? That's the question for each of us to ponder. Can we rise? Father, we pray that we would be ready, always ready, for the Christmas that's to come. This Christmas has already come and passed. More than 2,020 years ago, or so, give or take. But we also know, Lord, that coming up in this Christmas, we need to make things right. I've heard mumblings from people unable to forgive others. I've heard people stumbling in the darkness of their own lives. I've seen difficulties of running away from the spiritual responsibilities which you have given to us. And I know, Father, each of us needs to come to a place of readiness. Each of us needs to come to a place of saying, Christ, make a difference in our lives. This Christmas, teach us to turn that book into a book of the things that make you glorious. All the books that are written before you. Make us, Father, people who are writing it, glorious things for you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.